approximately equivalent in the energy that it provides per square inch or whatever square meter or more inch. If you're not convinced with this rotating stuff, there is another rotating stuff here. Electricity is used to produce light. Everything works perfectly. Yeah, okay. Civilization runs. And one even can power a motor. So this energy powers a motor. And in this little toy, there are ways to measure voltage, current, and explore how much electricity was produced, but those are technical details. So, what is the reason how this energy from sun is converted into electricity? So the dirt impurities of different nature, they can, so materials and all this, everything consists of atoms, ions, electrons, and when they're put together, they can exist in states with specific energy. So not any state of matter is allowed. And there are some electronic properties so that some of the states with lower energies are occupied by electrons, and some states with higher energy are not occupied by electrons. And typically such materials with this gap between occupied and unoccupied energies can serve as semiconductors for the physics audience and can serve as something that absorb or emit light from photochemical point of view. So this is a very schematic diagram of pure silicon. But as soon as we add impurities, it contributes additional states inside this forbidden energy. And some of them are occupied and some of them are unoccupied. Typically, it is the nature of electrons, the nature of humans, to take the lowest possible energy for laying down its equilibrium. So when two of these materials are brought into the contact, see this one is a little higher and it's occupied, symbolized by solid line. This one is unoccupied. So it is natural wish of an electron to jump from here to there. So from one area with one type of dirt to another area with another type. So it will form a charge transfer. An electron will transfer. And the transfer of electron, it is what the heart of all these devices. And in case, here, electron jump there. If you fully excited with light, you bring it back from here to there. So by applying light to the interface of this P and N doped oppositely dirty silicon, we can induce controlled charge transfer. And we can make this charge to go into the direction we want. So this is what we see here when this stuff is working. Why and how it goes? Well, I think these reactions of transferring the electron between the impurity centers is one key part, and another is that even if you apply light through the interaction, through disposing energy from electronic excitation into lattice vibrations, these electrons find their way to return to less energetic place. So the one key part is interaction with light, and another key part is interaction with lattice vibration, so dissipating energy. So launching some and then moving because energy photons form clouds, and they are in one type of impurity or another type of impurity, and when you photoexcite it, it goes from one state to another state. So it is, and when they communicate to each other, oh yeah, it is a charge transfer, it would be a good source of that. And is it good or bad? Very heavy. Do we have problems as scientists who try to be helpful to society? In part. So we do see that at least traffic lights are powered by some, not lights, but this science that measure speed. But there is a little luck in this setup that one needs to connect stuff with wires, so it is not portable. So we are almost happy. We have just a little thing to improve to make it portable, to take it with us into a trip and power our devices on our picnic or whatever. So here we come to the so-called concept of ever-controllers. So it is additional component, additional process that you can later connect with solar cell energy generation. So instead of using chemically aggressive or how do you call it, altruistic compound, we can have neutral electrodes and just communicate additional charge to them, and then make these electrodes to communicate charge to the protons and reduce protons into molecular hydrogen. Right? So it is the basics of electrolysis, and one can use some any source of energy, put two electrodes into a glass of water and observe. Let's wait a little bit, maybe by the end of our meeting it will be a little bigger, and then we'll try to see if you have the file. When I was a kid, I was using wires that are used for high voltage electricity. Usually they, aluminum is lighter than copper and less expensive than silver, and it is used whenever power is transmitted. And when these lines are built, there are a lot of leftover aluminum. So aluminum wires work perfect for this. Maybe we can try it soon.
It's gonna blow.
Okay, let's try this stuff first and then go I was checking. I wanted to do it. I even have a fuse that you mount a fuse, you ignite it, it flies a little bit apart from you and then explodes away. We can actually try it after the meeting when you read this. So electrolysis, communicating charge to electrodes and generating hydrogen. One doesn't need special equipment. It works with anything. The best way, I'm not demonstrating because there is some other experiments, but best way is to take a jump starter battery. It gives enough energy for electrolysis. Or even better thing, but a little more dangerous, is the equipment for welding. This gives you a good electrolysis. Okay. But we are targeting efficiency. So we want to use minimal amount of some energy and complete it, convert it by 100% efficiency into hydrogen, or 100% efficiency is not possible, so as close to 100 as possible. So there are some fancy electrodes that help us to do the job. So if these electrodes are made of so-called transition metals or noble metals, then this will be more efficient. I'm not saying that it will be cheaper, but it will be efficient as for the record. And one of the good metals to make in electrodes is platinum, especially if this platinum is cut into very tiny pieces, the pieces that are not smaller than wavelengths of a light. And another trick is to, so here are platinum, catalyzed platinum electrodes, and there are also little pieces of iridium, but they are on the nanoscale. And when, and also instead of water, they are connected through specific membrane that allows protons to go through membrane, but doesn't allow electrons to go through this membrane. So it doesn't differ from just putting electrodes into water, but it increases efficiency substantially. So in case, let me read the stuff that I found in Wikipedia recently. It's maybe something interesting for true chemists. So this is the material for this membrane that does conduct protons but does not conduct electrons. So it is similar by its composition. It is a polymer. It is somewhat similar to Teflon that we use on our frying pans, but it is more fractal. It is a tree-like arrangement, and it makes a little empty spots, empty channels where a proton can travel. Do not ask me. It is from the
computer. So does this help you separate the hydrogen from the oxygen?
Yes. 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 So the hydrogen is generated at one side of the membrane, and oxygen is generated on the other side of the membrane. And let's try it. So there is a membrane, there are electrodes that are very close to the left and right side of the membrane, and there are little containers for water. So it soaks the membrane and it allows the connection of protons, and electrons can go through the electrodes. So it is also water, just distilled with less concentration of impurities, because this platinum and iridium electrons are a little more expensive, and they can be poisoned by not pure enough water. So this is not an invention of the University of South Dakota. And it is not an invention of modern years. It is something known for decades, and this is just a little demonstration here. Feeling this water, then we up. And here will be a little spaces that can be filled by oxygen and hydrogen if the electrolysis process is efficient enough. So we take our solar cell that proved us to work, and we power it in a careful way. So black to black, red to red. And we do see, let's put it closer to our source, right? And this, although it can power a little lamp and a little water, this solar cell doesn't give much of energy. It is not the welding machine. It is not the jump starter. So it is very small, vanishing amount of energy. So in order to collect oxygen and hydrogen out of it, it should be really record efficiency. And we already started it a little ahead of time. Yes, yes, we should show bubbles. We should do bubbles, and the amount. This is why I decided to get serious. So, if the experiment goes well, right, then the volume displaced in one container should be twice as much as volume in another container. So it should be hydrogen to oxygen ratio. Well, here maybe because I'm not an experimentalist, it looks more like 1-to-1. But you can see I repeated the same procedure, and it has a little gas that was generated from electricity that was generated from solar panel, and please return it because we have another demonstration based on this little amount of gas. I promise not to burn, but it will be something probably fun. So, how does it work? Why communicating charge to electrodes, to platinum electrodes, generates hydrogen? Well, because it reduces protons from state when they have deprived electron to state when they have all the electrons in place, and then they fuse together. Let's see if this process is really true and if it is can be seen on the quantum chemistry side. So here's a little, by modeling, main thing is to neglect as much as you can. Otherwise, even nice modern computations become very expensive. So here, we neglect OH groups, we neglect all this projector, solar cell, we neglect any wiring, we keep only a little platinum cluster, and we have protons, H plus. And then we carefully add additional electrons to it and see what happens.
How exactly do you communicate charge again?
You just charge the system, though. You have you have more electrons now. It is not a big problem. You just make system charged.
Right.
Okay, and here is a few technical details. So if you want to go to professional community and tell everyone more details, you need to be more quantitative rather than qualitative. And you can measure distance from hydrogen to this platinum electrode, and you can measure distance to hydrogen and see how it evolves in time. So here, hydrogens were far enough from each other, and then they fuse and start oscillating because of vibrations. And the distance from platinum electrodes, it oscillates, and then starts writing. It is more quantitative way of looking onto this reaction. And what we see that if the amount of electrons communicated to the system matches the reaction, it goes most efficient. It will go with less efficiency even at different amounts, but the rate is much lower. So this basic reaction is supported by relatively simple computations. Oh, we can launch another one. That's the twister. Okay. Maybe not as energetic. And you see, there is a lot of water because the steam just it gets hot and it is a mix of hydrogen and water. We are not going to waste chemicals as we launch the reaction. That's kind of irresponsible.
Was this how they killed the
Hindenburg? Well, Hindenburg is an interesting story. And they, before it was burned, they made several discoveries, technological discoveries. They didn't knew that there will be space launching or this heavy, wide fuselage airplanes. So. One of the dangers was to store the fuel safely and do not make it too heavy. So they put a balloon inside a balloon. So this Hindenburg machine that was like flying stuff that is lighter than air. So there were ideas to fueling this helium, but helium is twice as worse. Commercial is less risky, but commercial not so efficient. So they put it filled with hydrogen, but to power the engine, to propel, they put the actual gas that we use in the kitchen, and they put it inside a balloon that was inside a balloon. And they call it blow gas technology. It was efficient, it was flying over the ocean. Okay, do we have this little toy? Why don't we take this hydrogen with us into the truck and power our devices on a picnic? So here is another technological secret that is already implemented, at least in some toys. So the same, very similar arrangement of electrodes can be used for the technology called fuel cell. So there's a reverse electrolysis that is generating electricity out of hydrogen and oxygen. So instead of one, they can combine together on catalytic surfaces and generate electricity. So here's a little schematic of what you have in this ongoing electrolysis. So here is this fancy polymer membrane. Here's a little graphite electrodes with deposited catalysts. And we put the water in as our supply, and we power these electrodes. And at the side where we have more electrons, water is converted into hydrogen, alkyl hydrogen. There is a channel of proton traveling through the membrane. And here there is an oxidation reaction that generates. Is what we have seen here. But if we are applying voltage, it has to go wild and stop doing it. Here, we disconnect it from the voltage. So, look at the arrows. Is it a rigorous thing? Yeah, so this is the technology. So we have a supply of hydrogen on one side, you have a supply of oxygen on another side, and we do not apply it. So rich groups here, and it forms water at both sides, and it does generate electricity, which goes in the opposite direction compared to what we were before. So fuel cell is an inverse electrolysis. Taking hydrogen and oxygen, it generates electricity. So probably, well, here's another one. Back, one hydrogen, two electrons. Let's check. Let's check whether you have anything, if you have this stuff rotating.
Jump started a few cars.
Okay, so here on the indicators, I do see a little bit of current, but that's good. So we're disconnecting it from the this stuff, from the solar panel, and connect it to the measuring tube.
Are we doing it more than
that? See, it starts rotating, and here it gets a little left.
But before this, you said it was
I put it in the opposite direction, and it was mixing with air. I probably do not qualify for experimental work. So I tried two tests, upside down, and one of them worked. So let's go wild and see if this energy is sufficient enough to do something a little bit more useful than demonstration. They shouldn't touch each other. Of water on the wheels. And I'm not sure that it will work, but we should try it. By hydrogen. Probably one needs some smoother surface because the friction with carpet will be too much for this stuff. But let's explore. It does.
Yeah.
Okay, so this hydrogen powered car. Can you catch it, please?
Sorry, I know it's signs and stuff. But
huh?
Well, so first you use sunlight to make hydrogen, then
yes.
You put it in a fuel cell that makes electricity. How is it better than using sunlight to make electricity?
Whoa.
You charge it. To power the car. You use sunlight to charge it, to create hydrogen.
Right.
What if I need to drive at night?
I see.
Okay. Well, sometimes you have to. You want to. So everything works. We are happy. Civilization goes forward. What? How can we prove how scientists can pull money from federal agencies? Well, I'm not going to hide it. So there is a opportunity, there is a chance to make it more efficient. I haven't seen much of those stuff in streets. And the question is efficiency.
And safety.
Okay. Yes. Actually, on this demonstration kit, it is for middle school or high schools, and they tell to children, do not smoke for Yeah, so it is a probably evolution theory for making people not smoking it in the cars. So, but what can be done better? Right now, well, any process, any technological process are connected with losing energy. Energy is lost into anything. And one of the processes, it is lost into heat, into vibrations of materials. And just by electrons running through the ports, they lose energy. So making circuits as short as possible would be better, or avoid circuits. So I'm done, once again, with available technologies, and try to give a brief hint of what can be done further. So it's free, portable, but efficiency, it is okay, but we can try to get better. But what I'm going to tell, there will be no more demonstrations, because it is in theory and in some experimental labs, but not at the level to power actual motion. So one needs to design new materials and understand how the energy is lost into different processes. And another thing is to try to avoid wiring, to make it as concise, as small as possible, so there is no losses. And one of the motifs that I borrowed, synthetic motifs, that I borrowed from my colleagues at the University of South Dakota, there are two research groups, one by Professor Kudala and another by Professor Hofmeier, so that one can remove all wiring, make it on a nanoscale. So make, instead of wires, do some nanoconductor or nanosemiconductor and put this catalyst on the side of it, so that upon harvesting light, the excitation is split in the electrons and holes and directly go to catalyst. So avoiding wiring. And then hydrogen is generated on one side and oxygen generated on the other side. There is no wiring and there is no storage. It is right away from sun to green fuel to hydrogen. And if you want to chat on the
land mission, you can't drive at night.
Yeah. Well, one does one thing at a time. if you have hydrogen,
yes,
you'll find a way how to use it.
Yeah.
Let's focus just on generating. So here's the same schematic just on the energy diagram. So energy of photon is absorbed. And then there are different materials, green, red, blue. And through the selecting these materials, maybe doping, maybe just using different nanomaterials, one can drive the motion of charges in the opposite direction on the small nanoscale. And then on the small nanoscale have this reduction and oxidation reaction. And the way to look at it is to try ideas of nanoscience, where one can have the same stoichiometry, same chemically, the same material, but modify, tune its properties by changing size, shape, aspect ratio, and they are thinking of synthesizing by adding a little things, using my language. And having, for example, hydrogen dioxide in the form of thin fumes, nanorods, quantum versions, and solid ions. So it is very affordable. And it looks like a door to possible future of making more efficient solar cells. So I'm trying to collaborate with them with maybe nanorods and nanowires. This is only the beginning. get more understanding in how those nanostructures interact on one side with light and on another side with various vibrations. They were shaping here, interacting also with water, and by interacting with light, so it is not yet powering devices, it's just looking for the pathways of what I say here. Basically, it looks by examining it, energy is lost, and then it can be emitted or converted into the power, and the understanding of the mechanism of this process may also be explored with femtosecond spectroscopy tools. Immediately, one by one, as time passes by, it starts emitting light. Promising direction is to actually look onto the processes of interacting between water and this transition metal catalyst that are deposited on this nanomaterials that allow to harvest light. So maybe this piece of metal, true nano size, it is even smaller than nano. It's cluster. All the iridium dioxide and the semiconductor typically used in this business and interfacing water. So there will be not much changing, but at least the water molecules will be shaping. And if one looks tightly, some of these steps show from time to time water dissociation recombination. It is what will later contribute to this activity onto splitting water onto hydrogen, following the directions, pathways of photo excitations. So I think we have spent enough time for this informal meeting. So we went through basic in chemical and in level of complexity interaction of sodium with water. We looked into more of catalytic production of hydrogen, and then we looked through generating electricity from light, electrolysis of hydrogen, and then combining hydrogen and oxygen and generating electricity that can power stuff. And some open doors are available for us to potentially increase the efficiency of these devices. And maybe, this very optimistic lens, computation can guide design of this kind of materials. So batteries will tell that batteries may ever overcome.
But batteries, I don't know what that means. Battery's going to be safer than the storm.
But they're heavier. You can't fly. It's hard to fly a plane with batteries.
Also, worse if you have
what is the efficiency now of getting from sunlight to hydrogen, or even just sunlight to electricity.
Sunlight to electricity goes to 40%.
40?
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm just thinking how much of the Earth we need to cover with solar panels, So is your first computation 100% efficiency?
Yes.
Okay.
So we need to expand this area maybe twice or three times.
So solar panels, I think, are still less than 20%.
Commercial, yeah. And commercial that we
So even that'd be twice as big, right? Or twice the diameter.
Well, there should be a compromise between price of fabrication and efficiency.
Yeah, is another dimension.
Because the solar cells used for exploration of space, they are really efficient, but it is not affordable for households. So the idea is that even the simplest material, silicon, it works best if it is single crystal. But growing single crystals bigger than this size is not cheap.
I'm really curious. You know, there's a group of organisms on the planet that have been doing this for a very, very long time. So I'm just curious, how do these like Chinese deer compared to other plants do a similar thing during photosynthesis? Are we doing better than plants, or are they still beating us at it? To what degree are some of these concepts about increasing efficiency guided by what the biological world is already going up with?
Plants and we need different things. For plants, it is very local. It is, or for maybe for our body tissues, there is this adenosine triphosphate that is transferred, and it is something that goes into our genes and goes in both concentration everywhere. For as we read on the macroscopic devices scale, we need to have a tank of stuff. You cannot have it diluted. And probably here is the border between us and human organisms. They could be sometimes more efficient in collecting and converting.
I should say not, but it's also going to about 50%. Like plants, it's about 50%. 20% of sunlight is converting to chemical energy.
But that sunlight is helping to build carbon and then has stored for millions of years and it's converted as oil.
I have an acquaintance who,
so it's not that
who told me like he actually wrote a grant, but then he wasn't ready if he went through. The idea was, why should we do all this stuff? We can just use a little one cell organisms, make them growing, and then dry them and keep them. So we just beat the biological.
Yeah, they're making carbon fuels, they're not making hydrogen and oxygen. Yes. That's not necessarily true.
Well, okay.
So there are hydrogenases that do the conversion of protons to hydrogen.
Mm-hmm. By sunlight through photosynthesis?
Actually, it's just straight equilibrium. Right? So if you generate a proton, however you generate it, you can convert it to hydrogen. That's exactly what we've seen here.
Right? Are the two plants do that as photosynthesis?
They're not plants, they're bacteria. Right, and so these enzymes can go in both directions. So there's hydrogenases, nickel iron hydrogenases, and iron only hydrogenases. And depending that, and that's partly the way that some people are viewing the storage of hydrogen. It's actually stored as an acid, and then use a hydrogenase to then generate the hydrogen as you need it, and then you burn it instantaneously. So there's no, so if you have an accident, you still acid instead of explosive gas, right? And so you know, there's trade-offs, but you know, that's some of the things that have been looked at as far as this whole problem.
And there's thought that probably metals, after they have been used, they need additional effort to recycle. The chemicals can make them not so harmless. So this hydrogen has always has a danger to explode, but after explosion, no one will suffer.
It's as safe as all get.
If you survive, it'll be good. That's
right. So what is the conversion efficiency, the maximal conversion efficiency from sunlight to electricity, irrespective of converting to hydrogen, just direct efficiency from sunlight to electricity?
There is a limit. I wouldn't
thinking about, you know, solving our global energy crisis, do you put your money on hydrogen fuel cells or superconductivity that would allow distribution of direct electrical conversion to, you know, distant locations without loss?
Well, it is a debatable question, but I would put my money on hydrogen, because making superconductivity on this long, transmitting electricity to long distances is too expensive. You need to cool it, or even high temperature.
Well, I'm thinking high temperature superconductivity.
You know, high temperature superconductivity, it's still not room temperature. Needs, well, if we discuss all our conditions,
let's all move to Antarctica.
Power the
Any other questions?
You know it's
well. Thank you, Dimitri, for that electrifying presentation.